السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time we start anything meaningful, we start in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we praise Him, and at the same time we send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For he was the one who brought all the goodness to us. Allah chose him to do that. And we ask Allah to bless his household, for they were the ones who supported him. They were the ones who struggled and strove from the very beginning, including his companions. May Allah bless them all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all those who struggled and strove through the years in a way that today the deen has come to us. And may he make us have the same concern that they had, in a way that the deen would be able to continue into our generations. And may Allah keep them on the straight path up to the last day. Ameen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, if I were to tell you that at the college you go, or the workplace that you are employed at, if you were to make a mistake and you went to your boss and you told him, "I'm sorry," what would he do? It depends. He might penalize you, he might not penalize you. He might say, "It's fine." If you really are sorry, you will prove to him that what I did is wrong, and from now on you will see that I'm not going to do that. I'm going to be an asset to this business. Or if you're a school child or school going age, varsity or anywhere else, even if it's a madrasa, and you did something wrong and you were about to be expelled, or you were about to be penalized, and then you went and you said, "I'm very sorry, I really apologize, I did this, it was out of human error and so on, and I will prove to you that I'm going to be a good student from now on." In that case, they may forgive you. They may say, "You know what, we will let you have another chance." Then you come back some days later and the same thing has happened again. Then what happens? They may let you off for a second time. The third time, I doubted that many places would let you off. Even sometimes family members might not let you off a third time round. May Allah protect us and grant us goodness. Why did I choose to start in this way? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares himself most forgiving, most merciful. But we should not be playing a game with Allah. He is not a little infant, nor is he someone who's employed us, nor is he a person running a school, astaghfirullah. He is far higher. He is Rabbul Alameen, Lord of the worlds. He has set aside rules and regulations that we will have to operate by whilst we happen to be living on this particular earth. And Allah has given us a uniform to wear whilst we are here. This uniform is made up of two things: that which He chose for us and that which He has allowed us to choose. What did He choose as a uniform for me and for you? The body you have and I have. It's a uniform. When you die, you will remove that uniform. It will be placed back into the earth, like Allah says, "Minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra." We have created you from that soil. We will return you into that soil, and we will resurrect you back from that soil. So this body is a uniform. My soul will depart the body, which is the uniform, and it will carry on. There is no more use for that particular body. Because in Jannah, may Allah grant us Jannah, we will be having a perfect body, something that Allah has chosen for us, different size and different nature. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us paradise.
Amen.
So that is one thing He chose for us. We have no decision. This is why you cannot go and start having plastic surgery on your face just because you want to change what you look like. Nor can you start tattooing yourself, all that is prohibited. Because it is Allah's amana. It's like a policeman who has a uniform and he starts writing big things on that uniform. Not allowed. He needs to keep it neat and prim, prop. You have a school uniform and you write the name of another school on your uniform, doesn't make sense. So Allah's given you something, you don't tattoo it, you don't pierce it, unless it is permissible, meaning for women, they may pierce their ears or their noses, nowhere else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and protection. So that is one uniform. The other uniform, the clothing we have, the outer clothing. We need to adorn ourselves in a uniform. Who would dare go to one of the top schools of this country and pitch up, decide that I'm not wearing uniform? They'll throw you right out. So much so, I went to a school where if your socks were not up and held up by what was known as a garter, you were told to go home and collect the garter. It's a little piece of elastic that holds your sock up. This is how strict people who are running schools have to be in order to protect the school from hooligans and so on, whatever their reasons. Why is it we have something much more sophisticated than a school? And the rules are much more lenient than any school, but still we don't want to adopt it. You find the women folk not interested in wearing the uniform. Men folk not interested in wearing the uniform. Allahu Akbar. May Allah strengthen us. May we learn to love the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a way that we begin to realize the importance of adopting it and following it. Every one of us is on a level. We need to work to get to a level slightly higher. Don't ever think, now I'm on a level and that's it, I'm sitting. You're not a Nabi, nor are you an angel. You're a mere human being. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us upliftment as the days pass, and may He never take us back. So it's important for us to know these are two uniforms. One is your body and the other is what you adorn yourself with. It is absolutely unacceptable for us to become oblivious of it even for a split moment. To forget that this is from Allah. This is Allah's instruction. We are in something that is similar, and I'm giving the similarity to just bring it closer to our minds, similar to a school where you are learning things, you write your examinations time and time again, you write the exams, you pass on to the next level, and you get harder examinations. عِظَمُ الْأَجْرِ مَعَ عِظَمِ الْإِبْتِلَاءِ. The hadith says, the bigger the examination, the bigger the reward. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهِ. When Allah loves you, He tests you more. You want to choose a head boy in the school, you need to choose the one who is the best. Right? Because you know you're going to be adding an extra burden. He might have more sleepless nights than the others because his position is higher. This is only an example. So within that school, we should understand in this life, we will have something similar. You grow up, you have one test, you have another test. You learn how to read the Quran, understand it, apply it. There is no point in going to a school and learning everything, and the day of the test, we say, I know the answers, but I'm not ready to write them down. You'd be a fool. Brothers and sisters, we know the answers. We know the deen. We know the regulations. We know halal. We know haram. It's about time we wrote it down, acted upon it. No point in saying, I know this is now doubtful, but you know, I'm hungry. You know, I'm skral, as they say. You know, I need to eat. That's not good enough. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Really. We need to apply it so that we get to the next level. You get to the next level, and then you will be able to have a bigger examination. Allah will test you with something more and more until you graduate. The certificate you get at school, say for example grade 7, grade 8, you get certificates every year, you go to the next year. When will you be able to use your certificates at the end? When you come out of university and you have your degree, you can now use that applying to get a job. And then you say, I've got a top job because I work very hard and I've got top results, and this is what it is. You will be able to use your certificates that you achieved in this life once you cross over beyond death into the Akhirah. Then you have your certificates. I worked hard, I've got all A's and so on. The Quran speaks about it. Let's listen to the verses of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ فِي يَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَهُ. As for the one who gets his results, his book of records, which means whatever he's achieved, the A's or B's or the fail, whatever it is, the one who gets his book on his right hand or in his right hand, he will say, hey, read my book. He's proud, he's happy. Like the children are happy when they have all A's and distinctions. And they say, I was top in matric. Dad, look at it. And dad says, you made me proud, my son. Allahu Akbar. The proper pride will be on the day of judgment when we are given our books in our right hands. May Allah grant that to us. Amen. We are deceived in this world. Because the same son who came with all A's, go and ask those who've lost such children before they could actually get a job. How did the school come handy? Nothing. This is why yesterday I was speaking to a group of friends and we were saying, you know, when parents are wealthy, it's their duty to help their children to get married. It might not be farab for you to spend extra and more and so on. You know, some people, sometimes you do have a case where perhaps the bride's family might be more wealthy than the groom's family. So without wanting to actually take control over this groom, because that's sometimes looked down upon in society, if the man would like to help his son-in-law, no problem. He's using his wealth in a big ibadah. And he's actually facilitating. What the question we were raising was, if he doesn't do that, the people will be fighting for that money once he dies. He'd rather have spent it properly in his life. Allahu Akbar. So this is why we say some people who earn the millions and billions have never benefited from it because they didn't spend it. They just amassed it. Same applies. Some people are sharp and intelligent. They have A's, they have degrees, they have PhDs. They did not benefit from it at all. The day they die, nobody's going to say, hang on, let me go to the lounge. There's his big framed PhD certificate. Put it on his chest so that Jibreel can see that this man had a PhD. Never ever. That's blasphemy. That is wrong. That is stupidity. Nobody would do that. Because they know it doesn't help. It's a paper. All that knowledge can only help you for as long as you are breathing. Even not so. I can change what I just said. It can only help you for as long as you are healthy. Once Allah takes your health away, it's over. This is why you get to a certain age. You can have the highest qualifications in the world. They retire you. Finished. Retired. Why? To show you that whatever you did, waste of time. Throw it out. We're getting the younger people. And if they can replace you with a machine, you're dead meat. Allah protect us. Amen. Today they're replacing human beings with machines. You know that. People's jobs are on the line because they know. But Allah is showing you, oh man, you can be as sharp as you want. If you did nothing about your deen, you have wasted your time. If you did nothing about your link with Allah, you wasted your time. If you did not get closer to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're wasting your time. And we hear it every day. We hear it every Friday. We know about it. We've heard it on the radios. We've seen it wherever else we've been. And we know what is expected of us. Shaytan makes us look for excuses. No man, I'm not yet ready. Come on. You want me to grow my beard? Not yet. You know what? I'll just wait for a little bit more. And Allah says, you know, even if you made the intention, it would have been enough. You did not know today was your last day. May Allah open our doors. Allah grant us the ability to change. It's a click. It's a switch. It has to turn. You need to turn it. Because if you don't, your switch may be turned off before you know. This is the thing. And this is why we tend to become so deeply engrossed in worldly material items that Allah has drawn our attention to something else. What is that? When He describes Jannah through the blessed lips of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a narration that we all should be knowing of by heart. فِيهَا مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. In that paradise, there is that which no eyes have ever seen. Which means if you think that there are beautiful things in this world, they do not qualify to come to Jannah. They don't. Not one thing from amongst the material items of the world. وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ. No ears have ever heard of. So if you've heard of anything, Jannah will be far better than that. The items you've heard of will never qualify to enter. وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. And man's mind is so small that it would never have crossed his mind that this is what I would actually get in paradise. So if anything has crossed your mind, in paradise is far better than this. Remember that. And if you take it further, you will come to understand. Did you ever think for a moment that anything you find fancy and good and you work towards and you toil for in terms of materialistic items that are of benefit to you in the dunya, it can only be from the dunya, nowhere else. What does this mean? It means, say for example, you love a motor vehicle. Well, the tin is from the mountain. They mined it there. The steel is also from under the ground. The fuel you use is from under the ground. The leather is from the cow. What else? You name it, it's all from the dunya. There's nothing from Pluto or Venus. Nothing. Nothing from the moon. Not at all. So it's only the world. Allah says, what you have seen yet is only from the earth, which is one of the smallest planets in existence. This is what it is. And we're busy committing adultery, going to the casinos. We're busy not wanting to turn to the deen. We can't give up a cigarette. We cannot give up alcohol. We can't give up drugs. We have to bash our wives and we have to beat up our children and we don't want to come home on time and we've got no time to read our salah. And Allah says, man, you know how insignificant you are. If we were to take you up slightly higher in your own atmosphere, you won't even see your house and you won't even see the 100 people who are in your house. If you take off on an aircraft, you can see the little cars. They look like dinkies. A dinky, we used to call it dinky. Small little car. Nowadays you get big remote control cars, mashallah. So these little dinkies, real cars look like that. And when you climb slightly higher, you cannot see anything, nothing. And Allah says, hang on, you're still in the earth's atmosphere. Can you see anything? No. Well, you still want to commit adultery. The woman you did it with, do you know what? At the moment, she is smaller than a speck of dust. Can you see? And you're still in the earth's atmosphere. Was it worth it? No, it wasn't. Why didn't you switch your switch on before it was switched off? This is the message I have for myself to start with. We know what's right and wrong. It's not good enough for me to come here and say, okay, this is right, this is wrong, this is right. Sometimes the details we are reminded of constantly. The true question is, when are you ready to start walking the talk? When are you ready to do it? Are you ready? If you are not, wallahi, we might not see the sun again. We could never come out of the masjid if Allah wills. It can happen. So let us wake ourselves up. Ask yourself, what is it that I want before I turn to Allah? Do I want a huge clap across my face? Do I want to suddenly be diagnosed with cancer or AIDS before I turn? Allah safeguard us and grant cure to those who are sick and ill. Amen. Do I want a huge loss and a robbery and the death of people I love around me and some major accident where my legs are crushed before I turn? Allah says, hang on, we still are merciful. If we do that for you, you still have hope. You might suffer in the dunya a little bit. If a person's had a huge crash and that made them come to the masjid, subhanallah, Allah loves them. Because Allah says, we tapped you. We tried to draw your attention by giving you, you didn't come. So we took away from you, now you came. We still love you. Wow, Allahu Akbar. Why do we have to wait for things to be taken away from us before we turn to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do we have to miss a salah? The minute the time of salah enters, you must have a rash on your bottoms. You can't sit until you've read that salah. It's a fact. That's a mu'min. A person who's really restless until the salah is over. Today what we do, shaitan comes to us. Time of salah, he says, don't worry, it's just awwal waqt. It's still the beginning time. It's okay, we'll wait for a while. And then come last time, you're running, you know, sun is setting at 20 past 5, half past 5, 25 past, you're busy making your asr salah. That happens every single day. Is that how you're treating Allah? Imagine a person coming late to school every day. After a certain time, they'll meet your parents, they'll do something, they might even kick you out of the school and say, you know what, you're not fit to be here. Every day, if it was once or twice, okay, fair enough. But this, we do it with salah. Salah is a gift, 24 minutes in 24 hours. We cannot give it still. We find ourselves lazy. Wallahi, the hypocrisy shaitan makes us get into is 7 o'clock you wake up for work, but 6 o'clock you won't wake up for salah. And you have to wake up 5 minutes after that, we'll wake up. And we won't even think for a minute, today is the last opportunity I ever had to read Salatul Fajr. And Allah is taking me away by Dhuhr Salah. This is why the hadith says, Salli Salata Muwadda'in. When you read your salah, read it as though it's the last salah you're ever going to get an opportunity to read. There are millions and billions of people who are in their graves wishing that they could be returned to engage in one sajda. And here we are alive. We don't want to engage in those sujood. And then when we come for salah, we peck the ground so quickly, not realizing the closest you are, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ لِرَبِّهِ وَهُوَ أَجِدُ. The closest that a slave is to his Rabb is when he's in sujood. Take your time. Add one or two more Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. See what happens. When you're coming up, take release slowly. The king of the worlds, the king of kings, the lord of the worlds is whom you are in front of. Don't rush. Imagine, Allahu Akbar, what we call a wake-up call to say, you know what? Reality strikes. Soon we are going to leave the school of ours. Whatever certificate you have, that is what will help you getting across. That is what will help you getting across. So it's up to you what type of examination you want to write. What is it that you would like to achieve? If you failed once, and this brings me back to the beginning of my talk. You failed once, you can rewrite. You failed twice, you can rewrite. For as long as you're alive, you have hope. You can write again. How many people get their matric at the age of 25, 30, 35? Some older people get a university degree at the age of 50 and beyond. Why? Because they don't want to lose hope without realizing it's only going to help me for another 5 years before I go. What about the big degree that we need in order to live the eternal life? This life is only 60 to 70 years approximately, if you're lucky, that is. And beyond that, not 600 years. Today I was reading a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he was explaining the door of the garden of one of us. May Allah grant us Jannah. The garden meaning Jannah. To get from one side of it to the other, you would have to walk for 40 years. Subhanallah. And I'm thinking to myself today, without a joke, in 40 hours I can cross the whole globe by plane and come back to Joburg. And that's with a slow Airbus. Slow meaning it only moves at 900 k's an hour. Imagine. Allahu Akbar. 40 years for one door. Wonder what's inside. They say, the hadith says, the tree would be such that if you were to walk in its shade for 100 years, you'd still be in its shade. Allahu Akbar. What are you talking about? You walking in the shade of your tree longer than you ever were in the whole dunya, your entire life. And we are busy sitting in this dunya thinking, you know what, it's eternal. We can't give up adultery. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. We cannot give up gambling. I'm repeating this because these are the problems of the age. We cannot give up pornography. We cannot give up haram relations. The sending of wrong pictures to other people on their phones. It's happening. Believe me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Really, the challenges are plenty. So what is the hope? The hope is we are facing Rabbun Rahim. We are facing a Rabb, a maker, who is much more merciful than anything in existence. He has created mercy and divided it into 100 parts. One, sent it down. 99, he kept with him. Subhanallah. So all the mercy you ever see is part of the one portion. The 99, inshallah, we will achieve from. From that, we will enter paradise. May Allah grant it to us. So brothers and sisters, it's about time we asked ourselves some serious questions. Serious questions. What is the main question? When am I turning to Allah? What is it that I'm waiting for before I decide to change my bad ways and habits? Have I recognized shaitan who is trying to lead me astray? And have I chosen a different path? There were some people at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam so powerful that shaitan recognized them to the degree that he stayed away from them. Can I give you one example? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. The hadith says, when he walked down one gully, shaitan ran through the other gully. He didn't even want to cross paths. Because not only did Umar recognize the devil, but the devil knew this man, no chance whatsoever. But with us, we look sometimes for the shaitan. Allah protect us. This is why sometimes I say, and may Allah safeguard all of us, we really think up items as human beings such that even the devil is ashamed of us. Hey, I didn't think of this, that was you. May Allah protect us. Really. Let's turn to Allah in Tawbah. Let's ask Allah's forgiveness. Not once or twice, every day 100 times. Don't worry. Repeat it, Allah will forgive you. You are breathing, Allah will forgive you. Have hope in the mercy of Allah. He will grant you paradise through the intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We utter such a beautiful shahada. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. You know what it means, I know what it means. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is a more powerful statement than anything that can exist. Subhanallah. That is what will drive me to Jannah and you to Jannah. May Allah grant us paradise through the intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need to try at least in order to earn that intercession. There's no point in saying, well, you'll get intercession, don't worry, man. I read a hadith which says you've uttered La ilaha illallah once, you'll get paradise. I'll wait, I uttered it many times. No way. You don't know if what you said was accepted. It can only be accepted if you are working towards it. You know, you can have citizenship of your own country that you were born in. If they want to strip you of it, they may do so, depending on what you've done. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all, and may He grant us goodness, inshallah. This was a very short pep talk, I hope, and I pray that it has affected me, inshallah, to lead a better life from now, and to become more conscious of my weaknesses. No matter what type of spiritual level I think I'm on, I need to work on my weaknesses. And so does everyone else. May Allah bless us all, and may He help us to love one another for His sake. And may we be as an ummah, such that nobody would dare trample upon us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love us all. And may we be from amongst those who are the lovers of Allah. Until we meet again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.